Let's do this. Let's go before the Lord in prayer, and let's ask the Holy Spirit to speak to us today. Father, we come before you, Lord, and we just thank you for the opportunity that we have to be in the house of God. Lord, we don't come for tradition. We don't come for ritual. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man or from a woman, or from the old or from the young. We come to hear from you, and we ask today that your Holy Spirit would speak to us, Lord, as we look into your word, as we look into your precepts, as we look into your will for our lives. God, I pray that we would take it to heart, Lord, that we would hear what you have to say, Lord, and we would take it and we would apply it in our lives. And God, as we do, I thank you for miraculous results in our lives, Father. I thank you for immense breathing room in our lives to do what you have called us to do. And God, we give you the praise and the glory for that. We ask that you would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world today that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for today, a special prayer for our brothers and sisters in Rock Church of Temecula Valley as they are opening and celebrating a brand new campus today. God, we thank you that you would bless them and just cause immense and miraculous growth there in Murrieta as they reach the Temecula Valley for Jesus Christ. Bless Pastors Henny and Miranda Bosman. In Jesus' mighty name, we all together said, amen. Amen. That's right. Our church, my sister's church, Miranda and Henny Bosman, they are opening a new building. They have a brand new celebration service today, the Rock Church of Temecula Valley. Pastor Jim and Deborah are there right now celebrating with them. Pastors Dan and Pastor Jess are hanging out with Pastor Eddie and Donna today in Coachella. The cat's away and the mice is going to play. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. All right. No, I'm just kidding. But we're going to get into the Word of God today, and we have been in this series called Breathing Room. Now, Breathing Room is a series that we want to talk to you about what God has to say about our biblical finances. And I understand oftentimes it's difficult, especially when we look at the challenge of what God wants to do in your financial life. And oftentimes what we're talking about is so very countercultural to our society. And today's message is absolutely part of that. And I want to get into it, and I want to go right into Breathing Room. This is part number 5, and we've been talking about God's plan and God's ideas for your financial freedom and your financial stewardship to have breathing room in your life. And we want to talk about that and continue. Today we're going to talk about making change in our life. And it's really a culmination of everything we've been discussing. Now we're going to start bringing it all together and start to see the realities of what God wants for your life. Did you know that the advertising industry in the United States is a $500 billion a year industry? $500 billion a year is spent on marketing and on advertising, on commercials, on advertisements, on billboards, on whatever you want to call it, any way to get a message into your hands, in front of your eyes. The United States spends $500 billion, not million, billion dollars every year. We know this. Why? Because we're excited about the Super Bowl and when we see Doritos spending $20 million on one advertisement. You want to say like, man, what did you get for $20 million? And then at the end of the commercial, we're like, for real? You spent $20 million on that? Either way, we know. And so the whole point is our industries, they're trying to do something. What are they trying to do? They're trying to get you to spend your hard-earned money and my hard-earned money on their products, on their services, to get us to buy into what they have. Why? Ultimately, to try and make our lives better. Why? Because we believe in America, there's a system that we operate in. And listen, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to talk really countercultural today. And if you've been in this, listen, I've been there today. I've been there myself. And there's areas where I still have to continue to check myself in that. Nobody in this place is a bad person for living this way. Nobody in this place is evil or wrong or in rebellion. We have just been led astray by the ways of our culture, by the ways of our society. And I'm not trying to tell you that we're, you know, I'm not trying to get conspiracy theorist on you or anything like that. The ultimate reality is that all of us in America and around the world have bought into a system of belief that has been influenced by the spirit of mammon, the spirit that rests upon money we talked about, that says, I can do this outside of God. And that influences this. And how do people get you to buy their products? By telling you this, that your standard of living is equal to your quality of life. Think about it for a moment. If you have the nicer house, you'll have a nicer life, right? If you have a newer car, the newer tires, the new shocks, if you've got the latest phone, you've got the most TV channels, if you've got the biggest TV, right? Forget 32 inches. That's not even a big screen TV anymore. Remember when those were big, right? Not even 42 inches anymore. Like not even 50 inches, right? Now they're like 60 inches. Now you're starting. That's like the base package, right? You go to Costco. It's like, you know, get into TV at 60 inches, right? Now it's like 80 inches, 90 inches, 108. Now they're so big, you can't even see the whole TV. TV, they got to curve it around the living room, right? You know, standard of living equals quality of life. In order to enjoy life, you got to have the home theater system, right? And you got to get the reclining chairs. And if you're really living it, you get the reclining chairs that massage you while you're going, because you want to have a good life and I want to have a good life. So we have lived and we have been told and we have been instructed all of our lives, all around the world, that our standard of living is equal to the quality of our life. Thus, we try to have a high standard of living so that we could have a high quality of life. And as a matter of fact, we know this. We've seen this. We've seen the condition of this. We've seen the results of this in our life. Commercials and industries have even poked fun at that. As a matter of fact, there was a lending commercial a couple of years ago that really emphasized the standard of living and quality of life from a commercial. And I thought I'd bring that commercial just to remind you of how our standard of living, we think, is equal to our quality of life. Check out this funny commercial. So we think that the standard of our living is equal to the quality of our life. If you put it into a mathematic equation, they've got the equal sign there. But you see, you got to understand something. That the truth of the matter is, and we know this, that your standard of living is not equal to your quality of life. How do we know this? Is there anybody in this place that's married today? Any of my married people? Anybody in here that's ever been married before? Well, a bunch of y'all raised your hands. Man, all right. Hey, God's not done with us yet. Amen. You know this. You know exactly that principle. Why? Because you could have the best house. You could have the best car. You could have the best vacation home. You could have the best toys. You could have everything you want, but yet you can still sit in the driveway of your nice home in your brand new car and still have to brace yourself to walk in the door to face that person on the other side of that door and still not have a good marriage. I mean, look at Hollywood. Look at celebrities. Almost limitless finances, limitless resources, but yet they can't seem to make a marriage work. Why? Because your standard of living is not equal to the quality of your life. And over the course of Breathing Room, we've been discussing subjects that pertain to this idea, and we're going to continue looking at this and see what God has in store for us. But it's so important for us to understand and to know how critical it is for us to live in the mindset of God. You remember the Bible says that God said, "My ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts." Why? God said, "My ways are higher than your ways." So our ways, our standard of living is equal to quality of life. But God says, "No, that is not my ways. That is not my thoughts. They are higher than your thoughts." And I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to say it. It might even offend some of you in this place, but it's so true that we've got to understand this today. It is so important that we understand what we're talking about within this financial series, that you cannot be a follower of Jesus and ignore it. You're like, "Pastor, look, I didn't want to come to church today, and now I really don't want to be here." You see, Jesus said this. We were there in the very beginning of this. Matthew, the 6th chapter, Jesus said it like this. He says, "You cannot serve two masters at once." He says, "You will either love one and hate the other, or you will be loyal to one and despise the other." And Jesus says it like this. He says, "You cannot serve God and mammon." What is mammon? We talked about mammon. Mammon is the spirit of the world that rests upon our money that says, "I can do this without God." What is the influence of mammon? The influence of mammon, listen to this, is your standard of living is equal to your quality of life. And Jesus says, you cannot serve the systems of the world. You cannot live with the mindset of the systems of the world and live with the mindset of God, because you are a double-minded man in all of your, unstable in all of your ways. And James says, let not that man suppose he'll receive anything from God. It is that important for us. You see, we want to come to God and say, "God, I'll give you my worship. God, I'll give you my praise. God, I'll give you my healing. God, I'll give you my church attendance. But Lord, I don't want y'all to touch my money." Why? Because the church, they just want my money. Can I just tell you something right now? It's not about what the church wants from you. It's all about what the church wants for you. And what we want for you is God's system of economic prosperity on your life and not the world's. Because the world will tell you, your culture will tell you, that you've got to have a high standard of living to have a high quality of life. But just even for me, having returned from a third world country where the average person in that country makes less than $1,000 a year, that's less than $2 a day. They have a higher standard of living in their lives than they do, a higher quality of life than many Americans today. Why? Because they're not wrapped up in what everybody's thinking about them. They're not wrapped up on what shirt they're wearing. They're not wrapped up in their car. They're not wrapped up in their home. They're not wrapped up in their Facebook profile. They're wrapped up in Jesus. They're wrapped up in life. They're wrapped up in their family. They're wrapped up in the things that matter in this world. And so we've got to understand, God says, I don't want you to live like everybody else lives, because my ways are higher, my thoughts are higher. And so we've got to come to the reality that we can no longer think and live the way our culture and society tells us to live. And it's so important for us. That's why we're talking about breathing. What is breathing room after all? I mean, what is that whole idea of breathing room? Let me tell you what breathing room is. Breathing room is the space to move, the ability to breathe free. Think about it. It's the lack of confinement. If you see the graphic image of breathing room, there's a guy stuck in a cubic box, claustrophobic. Oftentimes, we as Americans, we live a claustrophobic financial life. We want to do something. Man, I would love to sponsor a child around the world, or I would love to give into missions, or I would love to do something, but I just can't do that right now because I don't have any breathing room in my life. And that's the whole idea of what we're talking about here at the Rock Church, is to teach what God wants for you and I. I'm a real illustrative person. I like visuals. I like to see things. You know, it's one thing to explain it, but it's another thing to see it in pictures. They say a picture say 1,000 words. So I thought I'd just show you what breathing room is and show you kind of where we are in comparison to breathing room. So I'm going to put up a graph behind me on the big screen. This graph represents you. It represents me. Now, on the x-axis of this graph is your money, my money. On the y-axis of this graph is time. So as your time progresses, here's what it should look like. As time progresses in your life, hopefully so does your money. It should go up, right? You say, Pastor Luke, that is not my life, right? My life kind of goes like this, and then it went like this, and then it went like that, and then it like went further down, and then like it broke through the, and then I got that bonus, and then it went up, but then I bought that car, and then it went really far down, and then the economy hit, and then it went boop, and I was trying to like breathe life into it. Over the course of the seasons of your life, whether it's the season you're in or whether it's the entire course of your life, if you look at like Wall Street from 1920 all the way to today, there's an upward progression. And so it might have a couple bumps and hiccups along the way, but hopefully this is your life. Your income will grow as your life begins to grow as well as time progresses. Now, God's plan for you and I is to be wise financial stewards, so he wants us to have some space in our life so our income will grow and so will our spending, but our spending will not grow at the rate of our income, so it'll actually look like this. And there is God's desire for you and I. And you see the space in between the red line, which is your spending, and the green line, which is your income. The space in between the two of them, that is called breathing room. That is the ability to move free. That is the ability to give generosity. That is the ability to give into missions or to help somebody out in time of need. That is the ability to not have the weights and the burdens of this world that rest upon your shoulders. This is God's desire for your life. But most Americans look like this. Let's go back to the very beginning. Our graph, right? Most Americans live their life like this. We say, oh, if I would just get a little bit more money, everything would be okay. But then you get a little bit more money, what happens? It tracks your spending exactly with it. And there is no breathing room. We say, man, I'd love to do something, but I just can't right now. It's just, there's a lot of things. I got a lot of responsibilities. I got a lot of obligations in my life. No breathing room to do anything. This is most Americans in the United States look like this. And you say, wow, on paper, that's kind of shocking. Well, let me show you something even more shocking. Many Americans in the United States actually look like this. Where your spending exceeds your income. Why? Because we want a high standard of living. And I don't have the resources to gain a high standard of living on my own. So what do? I borrow it. And I become like Stanley Johnson, in debt up to my eyeballs, with a nice car and a nice house, but then the bills come and I can barely make the minimum payments. That is called pressure and pain. And God says, this is not my plan for you. This is not God's desire for you. And you say, Pastor Luke, you don't even know. That's like my life, but my red line, my income is like this, right, going down. And the red line is like going up, like straight up. Pastor Luke, I am so far off, I can't even breathe. That's exactly why we're talking about breathing room. And that's exactly why we say you can't ignore what we're talking about here and follow Jesus, because God says, this is not my plan for you. My plan for you is to do something with your life to glorify the kingdom of God. Now, if you remember, I said that we were going to kind of bring it all back together. The very first week, we talked about the source of our provision, not being our income, not being our employment, not being our retirement, our social security, whatever it might be. The source of our provision coming from God. And I made this statement. I said that if God is your source of provision, then money will be your servant to build God's kingdom. But if money or mammon is your source of provision, God will not be your slave to get you more money. And that's exactly the problem, is that so many people within the church, so many Americans today, have the wrong mindset of our financial lives and what it should be like, because everybody else is living this way. As a matter of fact, let me show you. Don't just take my word for it. Let me show you. The Bureau of Labor Statistics for the United States government, as well as various credit reporting agencies, have given us all sorts of different information about the situation and the climate of the American economic makeup. So let me give you the averages based on the Bureau of Labor Statistics. Are you ready for it? The average American, 161 million people in America work and pay taxes. Based on 161 million people, the average working American carries a $15,000 credit card debt right now. Now think about this for a moment. If you know anything about mathematics and averages, this average includes those who carry a zero balance on a credit card. If you took the zero balance out, this number would triple, quadruple. Why? This is a weighted average of everybody in America, $15,000. So just look around. Don't make any eye contact. Most of the people in this building, that's you. That's what it's saying. Let's go a little bit further. The average baby boomer, are there any baby boomers in the house, right? You know, man, you guys were the drivers, man, getting it done, right? The average baby boomer carries $100,000 of debt. Wow, that's a lot. That's a lot of pressure. There's no breathing room there. How about this? Let's go a little bit further. The average Gen Xer, right? 1970s, 1980s, any MTV generation in there? Any Gen Xers? The average Gen Xer carries $110,000 of debt. It's growing. All right, now I got to ask, are there any millennials in the house, right? 1983 and above, right? Where's my millennials at? You're like, I'm not going to shout, Pastor Luke, because you're going to call me out right now. The average millennial carries right now, today, the average millennial carries $40,000 in debt. Well, Pastor Luke, that's good. That's good. It's going down. No, they're 20 years old. The average homeowner in California has more than $300,000 on their mortgage balance. That's the highest in any other state in the United States. We are number one. You're like, amen, praise the Lord. Have you seen what you could get in California? I mean, you can't even get nothing. That's why everybody's moving to Idaho, right? How about this? 50 states in the United States, right, plus many other territories, that make up the entire union of the United States, California, one state alone, makes up 1/12 of the entire credit system and debt system of the United States. That means 1/12 of all of the debt in the United States comes from California. Because you see, we have been told, we have been taught, we have been instructed, we have been commercialized and advertised too, that your standard of living is equal to your quality of life. And our Constitution tells us that it is a God-given right to pursue happiness. And so how do we pursue happiness? By trying to raise our standard of living and living outside of our means with no breathing room to do anything. But that's not God's plan for you. It's not that Visa is bad. It's not that MasterCard is the devil. It's not that Bank of America. You say, Pastor, you don't even know what they say on the phone. They are the devil. No, they are companies, businesses that are in business to facilitate what we Americans want, and that is a high standard of living for a high quality of life. You say, well, Pastor Luke, my financial status, my whole place, you don't even understand. It's not my fault. The economy crashed. It's the president's fault. It's the previous president's fault. It's Washington's fault. It's a corrupted system, and I'm just a victim of the world. No, it's nobody's fault but our own. Why? Because we are simply reaping what we have sown all of our lives, that we want a high standard of living because we want a high quality of life, and we have got to separate the two when it comes to God. Why? Because your quality of life is based upon Jesus, not upon your finances. And so we need to get to this place of breathing room. Why? So that we can get out from underneath the pressures of the economic systems of the world and that we can breathe. We can lay our heads down at night and think about our children and think about our families and think about how we can bless God instead of thinking about how we can make ends meet. That's God's desire for us. And so this is why we discuss and this is why we get into the subject and the topic of breathing room so that we can live God's plan and desires for our life. And the question then goes, how do we have breathing room in our lives? Well, there's two things and two separate formulas that we have to understand are not the same. Standard of living and quality of life. How do you have a high standard of living? Debt. How do you have a high quality of life? Discipline. Two different things, two different categories, two different results. And so we have to do something in order to have breathing room. And I'm going to tell you, the solution, you already know it. You're smart. You're not dumb. You're not stupid. You're not ignorant. Everybody in this place, I know it. You know what to do. You're smart enough to figure it out. The only thing is that it's a very hard thing to do. And how do we have breathing room in our life? Very simple how we do it. You've got to decide to make a change. Albert Einstein said it like this. Albert Einstein said, insanity, the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. There are 340 million people in the United States doing the exact same thing that you are doing, expecting to get the different result, expecting to make it, expecting to be the next Mark Zuckerberg or the next Major League Baseball player that makes it, and then everything, all your problems are taken care of. But can I tell you something? The more money you have does not mean the less pressures you have. The pressure it takes to maintain a $50,000 a year job is immense. It's a lot. That's the average wage in America. But did you know that the pressure to maintain a $250,000 a year job is even more, exponentially more? Why? Because if you lose a $50,000 a year job, you could probably come by another $50,000 a year job. But it is very hard to come by a $200,000, $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 a year job. Chances are, ain't going to happen again. So more money does not solve the problem. The problem needs to be solved by the change of our mindset, and that is the decide to make a change in our lives. I'm going to tell you something. I know something about every one of you in this building. As a matter of fact, I'm going to go as far as say, I know something about every person in this church and every person in America. You want to know what it is? You're like, man, how do you know this? Because I've studied. No, you want to know what it is? That every one of you in this place, and myself included, live on a percentage of your income. Every one of us lives. Some of you live on 20%, some of you live on 50%, some of you live on 175% of your income. That's that red line going through the wall, like skyrocketing up, right? You see, the very first thing you and I have to do is we have to make a decision. What am I going to live on? What do I really need? What is in my life? How about this? How much is enough? How much in my life is enough? That's what we have to decide. You know, you think about it like this. I say you already know the answer. Why? Because it's like exercise. Everybody knows how to exercise. You say, I don't know how to exercise. I've been to the gym. I went and looked at that equipment. I couldn't figure it out. You know how to walk. You know how to run. Most of you know how to ride a bike. I even saw a guy one time. I was driving to church one day, and I saw a guy. He was out there exercising. You know what he was doing? He was lifting up a big rock. Just squatting a rock. You know how to do it. It's not exercising that's hard. What is it? It's the discipline to exercise that's hard. You see, so you know how to make the decision and the change in your life. It's the discipline to do it. And the very first thing you need to do is decide how much is enough. How do I decide how much is enough? You've got to take a look at your life. Jesus says, who's going to build a building without counting the cost, lest he try to finish it and not have enough money to finish his project and look like a fool? You see, how many of us live our lives and have no concept and no idea of how much of a percentage we live? Listen, if you don't decide on what percentage you live on in your life, the world will decide it for you. Has anybody ever bought a car from a dealership before? Anybody ever bought a car from a dealership? Let me see. No, I'm not. I love car salesmen, man. Car salesmen. Dude, they need to be more pastors that are car salesmen, man, because those guys are good, right? When you buy a car, what do? You go and you sit down, right? And they, okay, let me go talk to my boss. And they go, and let me talk to my boss. And, oh, man, I'm working hard for you, right? That's what they do, right? Having their lunch break in the back. I know. We know your tricks. And you say, okay, how much does the car cost, right? That's what you say. Just tell me how much it's going to cost me. Well, no, we'll get to that. Here's the question I want to ask you. Here's the question. How much can you pay a month, right? Isn't that what they ask? What can you afford? Well, you know, I can afford $350 a month. I can afford $500 a month. Well, I tell you what, I could get you into this $75,000 Escalade, right? into the new Tesla. You wanted that. You know, I could get it in. I could get it in your budget. You say, well, praise God, I can afford it. No, you can't. They just decided what percentage of your income you're going to live on. If you don't make a choice, they'll make it for you. Your TV provider, your cell phone provider, your car, your house, your bank, they will decide for you. It starts by making a choice. How do you make a choice? You look at your obligations. You've got obligations in your life. You've already got that. You've already got to pay for that. You can't walk away from that. Well, you can, but you still got to pay for it. You've got obligations, and then you've got necessities. Necessities, what are necessities? I got to eat, right? Those are necessities. I need food. Amen. Now, then you've got wants. Obligations, necessities, wants. Wants are you don't need to. You need to eat, but you don't need to eat a double-double. Now, here you go. I'm going to poke at you a little bit, all right? You need food, but you don't need the Venti Starbucks. You're like, yes, I do. Yes, I do. Get behind me, Satan. I need that. You've got to establish your obligations, your needs, and then your wants, and then make a decision in your life. What is the percentage you're going to live on? Well, one of the principles that we've learned is that, well, we know that God wants 10% of our income, right? That's a tithe. So a good starting place is 90%, but then you're going to want savings, you're going to want a rainy day, you're going to need an emergency fund, so forth and so on. So a lot of people believe in the 80-10-10 principle, you know, 80% you live on, 10% you save, 10% you give or you tithe. Whatever the decision is, you need to sit down, husbands and wife together, and make a decision. What are my obligations, what are my needs, and what are my wants, and what is the percentage of my life that I am going to live on? Count the cost of your life. The next thing you're going to have to do is you're going to have to watch your money. You got to watch it. Remember in Haggai, we talked about this, Haggai, the first chapter. Verse number 5 says it like this. It says, thus says the Lord God of hosts. You know when you read that in the Bible, you got to listen. Thus says the Lord God of hosts. It means listen, right? What does God say? God says, thus says the Lord God of hosts, consider your ways. Pay attention to your life. What does he say? He says you eat and you're not filled. You drink and you don't have enough. He says you put on clothes and you're never warm. He says you earn wages. You work to put your money into a bag with holes in it. You're like, praise the Lord. God knows my heart. Yes. And then what does he say again in verse number 6 or verse number 7? God says again, consider your ways. You know when God says something 2 times, we really ought to be listening to what God says. God says, consider your ways. You got to watch your money. Where is it going? Listen, we watch our real estate value. We watch the stock market. We watch our retirement accounts. We watch the Social Security. We watch Netflix. Right? But how many of us actually watch our dollars? Well, but Pastor Luke, you don't understand the condition that I'm in. A dollar here and a dollar there, it doesn't make a difference. Who cares? It makes all the difference. Why? Jesus said this. Jesus said that if you are faithful in the little, you will be faithful in the great. If you are unfaithful in the little, you will be unfaithful with the great. And so it makes all the world of difference where your dollar goes. So you've got to watch your money. How do you watch your money? I'm going to give you a real practical example, a real practical instructions to watch your money, okay? Here it is. Buy a little black book. Some of you men used to have one full of numbers, but it wasn't money. Some of y'all need to get rid of that book, right? Get yourself a little black book, and for the next 60 days, every dollar you spend, whether it's at Starbucks or at Stater Brothers, whether it's on gas or your electricity bill, whether it's your mortgage balance or your rent or child support, every dollar you spend for 60 days, write it down where it goes. There's even apps on your iPhone, your Android phone, your Windows phone, or your computer that you can log that down. You can even go right now on your bank account and if you use cards or use your ATM card, you can log and have a spreadsheet categorized for your spending. And you need to watch for 60 days every dollar you spend. I heard one pastor say it like this: everybody needs to be a knowing where their dollar is a going. You see, the average American spends $400 a month that they cannot account for. It's like socks in the dryer, it's your money. I don't even know where it went. Watch every dollar for 60 days and you'll find an account for that. Let me put that into perspective for you. Think about that for a moment. $400 a month. a month. That's $4,800 a year. Did you know that if you took every working person in the entire world, then the global average of the yearly wage around the world, the richest of the rich to the poorest of the poor, you know what it is? It's under $9,000 a year. That's the global average of what people make in the world, $9,000 a year. That means that the average American loses half of what most of the world makes in 1 year, and they don't even know where it went. And you see, we've got to consider our ways, to watch what our resources and our provision are going. God, I need you to bless my money. And God's like, I just want you to watch it. So make a decision. Pick a number. What are you going to live on? How much in your life is enough? Watch your money. Here's another next thing you're going to do. Next thing you're going to need to do is you're going to need to watch your money. The next thing you're going to do is you're going to need to... You're going to need to cut spending. There was one. There it is. That was like the pity amen, right? They're like, I don't want to talk about that. It might just be that you have to lower your standard of living to increase your quality of life. But like Pastor Joel and I were just talking about, lowering your standard of living to whose standards? You see, our standards of living have been based by everybody else. The advertisement, $500 billion a year, they're telling you what your standard of living is. And so you've got two options in life, a high standard of living or a quality of life. What are you going to do? You can do what the United States government's done and how frustrated we get when we see that. And there's a website dedicated to the national debt, right? $19 trillion. Every American owes $161,000 of debt to the United States Treasury. I mean, think about that for a moment. And so we look at the government and we say, y'all are stupid. Right? Fix the problem. And what do? We have a decision. We do exactly what they do. Well, we say, well, I can't make ends meet, so what am I going to do? Cut spending or raise the debt ceiling? That's what I'm going to do. So we've got to make a decision to cut spending. As a matter of fact, we know this. I said, you know this. You know, we poke fun at this all the time. Saturday Night Live a couple years ago did a little skit with Steve Martin, and I thought I'd show you about how we need to live our lives. Check it out. It's not the exercise that's hard. You know how to do it. It's the discipline to do it. And I heard one pastor teach a very similar message to this, and I had heard it, and I had taken it on my own life. And he made the statement that I think is so true for you and I. And the statement is this. The statement is, I want is better than I owe. I want is better than I owe. I want a new car is better than I owe on that car. I want that vacation is better than I owe on my vacation. I want nice food is better than I owe on food that never even satisfied me. The waiter didn't even do a good job. I want is better than I owe. But you see, we have been conditioned in our culture to say, well, if I want something, I'm going to go get it. Why? Because I want a higher standard of life, and that means a higher quality of life. But we have got to separate the two and realize and recognize that my quality of life is based solely upon Jesus Christ in my life. And my standard of living is irrelevant to my quality of life, because if I've got Jesus, I've got quality. So you've got to do a couple of things. You've got to decide to make a change. You've got to watch your money. You've got to do what the United States government has not yet decided to do, and that is to cut spending. And the last thing I want to tell you to do is simply easy, is this. It's to develop a debt retirement plan. To develop a debt retirement plan. Listen, Chase is not the devil. American Express is not the devil. Bank of America is not your enemy. They are businesses that have gone into business to facilitate your desire for a higher standard of living. And it's all great and wonderful when you get that card in the mail and it says you've got a $10,000 credit limit. You're like, man, I'm going to go on a shopping spree because I was just given $10,000. No, you weren't. And all of a sudden, they're the enemy when they start collecting and you can't pay. You see, the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs that the borrower is slave to the lender. And God doesn't want you to be a slave to anything. As a matter of fact, Paul the Apostle talks about it. He says, if we're slaves, we are slaves to righteousness with God. That our slavery to sin and our slavery to humanity and the conditions of humanity has gone and died with the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And now if we are slaves, we are slaves and servants to Jesus Christ, which means I am a servant of God, not a servant of my debt. The average American in the course of their life will spend 66.7% of their life servicing debt. 2/3 of your life, if you're an average American, will go towards servicing debt. God doesn't want that pressure on your life. Well, Pastor Luke, I've got a mortgage balance, and I've got a credit card balance, and I've already got, I can't. Pastor Luke, are you trying to tell me through the course of this message, is the final point that I got to sell all of my things, convert it to money, and give it to the poor, and take up my cross and follow Jesus and let him? No, that's not what I'm telling you to do. I'm telling you to make a decision. Are you going to follow the world, or are you going to follow God? And God doesn't want you to be a slave to American Express, to Visa, to Toyota Financial, to Bank of America, or Wells Fargo. God says, I want you to be a servant to me, and I will give you money as a servant to you to build my kingdom. Why? God wants breathing room in your life. And too many of us in the church, too many of us in America are drowning in our nice things as we miss the entire essence of what God wants for us. It's a hard message. I understand this, but let me tell you something. If it worked for me, what do you mean? It'll work for you. Because I'm not just a kid up here telling you something that I read out of a book or that I heard in a sermon or that my dad said, you need to preach this. I'm here to tell you that I was there, exactly where most Americans are. Why? Because I grew up like every other American. But if it works for me, it'll work for you. Why? Because these are the principles of God, not the principles of the world. And God says, I will bless when you follow after me. So how do you develop a debt retirement plan? Well, you start paying on your debt. Pastor Luke, you don't understand. I don't have any money to pay on my debt. If you don't have any money to pay on your debt, you don't have any money to pay except your minimum balance. I know this is hard. I'm going to refer you back to point number one. You got to make a decision in your life. How much are you going to live on? Well, Pastor Luke, I made a decision. I don't have any money. Point number two, watch your money. Start watching it. Pay attention. You'll find it. It's there somewhere. Pastor Luke, you don't even understand. It's not there somewhere. Watch it. Make a decision. Cut spending. Number three. And if you don't get there, then I'll tell you what. If you pay the minimum balance on your credit, listen, a $3,000 credit card with a minimum payment balance, you know how long it'll take you? It'll take you 16 years, and it will cost you $4,000 extra dollars to pay off that minimum balance. Pastor Luke, I am drowning. I don't even understand. There's no hope for my life. I cannot get out of water. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. I'm here to tell you right now, if there's anything else you get out of this today, listen, there's hope. There's hope. Why? Because you serve a God of miracles. You serve a God who is miraculous. You serve a God who loves you, who cares about you, who doesn't want this for you. And though you might be reaping what you have sown all the course of your life, there is a God out there who loves you. And all he's asking for you to do is make a decision to follow him, to trust in him, to follow the things that he has taught you and I to do, and let him take care of the rest. But it takes a wise and smart financial steward of his resources in order to do so. And I'm not going to try to recreate the wheel. How do you retire your debt? How do you develop a debt retirement plan? I'm not going to try to write it out. Why? Because I'm not a financial planner, but I'm not going to leave you hopeless. So here, I'm going to give you three simple options, and we'll finish with this, okay? Three simple options for you to develop a debt retirement plan. Okay, you guys ready? You want three options? Yes. Option number one, to get out of debt. You ready? Here it is. Option number one, go down to Barnes & Noble or go on Amazon.com or wherever else you want to buy a book from and buy Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover. Now, I'm not getting paid by Dave Ramsey to tell you this. All right, I'm telling you, if this works for me, it works for you. Why? Dave has spent his entire life developing the system. It's a proven system. I worked it in my own life. I'm not an endorsed person by him. I'm not even doing anything like that. I'm just telling you, it works. And Dave will teach you not just wise financial stewardship, he'll teach you biblical financial stewardship, Total Money Makeover. Now, the book will cost you $24.99. So you're saying, Pastor Luke, I can't do option number one. Why? Because I was the guy with the red line. Remember the red line? Pastor, I don't got $24.99 to go buy Dave Ramsey's book right now. I can't invest in that. Okay, I got you covered. I got a plan for you too. You ready? Okay? If you're taking notes, here it is. Okay? Option number two, go to your local bookstore or to your local library and go to the finance department of the bookstore and find Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover. Okay, and get the book and sit down on the floor and open the book and read chapter 7 right there in the store. Now, don't wrinkle the pages. Don't highlight it because you didn't buy the book. It's not your book, okay? But take 20 minutes and read chapter 7. It starts on page 109. Okay? All right. Option number two. Pastor Luke, ain't nobody got time for that. I don't want to be the guy tomorrow at 6 o'clock at Barnes & Noble, and all of a sudden there's like a Rock Church small group. So I ain't going to do that. Pastor Luke, I'm not going to do that because I don't want nobody to know. Okay, I got option number three for you. Here's option number three. Go to your local bookstore or your local library and go to the finance department of the store and find Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover and take your phone that you cannot afford and open it to page 111 and take a picture of page 111, 112, 113, and 114, and then go home and read the picture you took when you have time, most likely on the toilet. It's not hard. It's not difficult. It's not a lot of work. It's a lot of discipline. And let me just tell you something now. I'm going to give you my testimony because I just want to be real with you. I want to be open with you, all right? Can I be real? Can I just tell you? A lot of times preachers don't like to talk about money unless it's about them, right? I'll just tell you. Okay, here it is. 3 years ago when we started Freedom for Our Future, we developed a debt retirement plan for the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. At the very beginning of Freedom for Our Future, I was the campaign head, all right? I had a truck. I love it, man, my truck, my Toyota Tacoma. Amen. Praise the Lord. People are like, Pastor Luke, your truck is dirty. I'm like, that's how it should be. I owed $34,000 on my truck. I financed 100% of my truck. I owed $36,000 on Stacy's minivan. Yeah, I got a minivan, but I got a truck. So I'm confident in myself that I can drive a minivan too. So I had $70,000 in automobile debt. On top of that, I had a $10,000 credit card balance due. Stacy and I, we bought a mattress. You know, mattress salesmen are much like car salesmen. How much are you willing to invest in a good night's sleep? So we bought a mattress, and we've yet to have a good night's sleep on that mattress. Because it's all soft and cuddly in the store, right? And you feel like, oh, this is the best. And then you put a sheet on it, and all that soft goes away, right? So we had $2,000 in mattress bills. We had no savings account. The economy had tanked already. So we were putting into a 403B, which is the equivalent of a 401K, a retirement account. We stopped investing in our future. So we had no savings. We had no retirement plan. We had no money in the bank available to us to do anything. And we had about $80,000, $70,000 of consumer credit card debt. There was no way we were going to do this without God. And so as we began, we got into this, we heard these principles, we heard these precepts, we got into exactly what I told you, and we said, we're going to make a change. We're going to decide to do something different in our lives. And about a year went through, and after that, a year went through, and my position at the Rock changed, and they said, listen, your responsibilities change, and with responsibility, you need to have a raise. And so the church, I'm going to tell you, the church offered me, or gave me, a $400 a month raise. I mean, that is like miraculous. I'm like, praise the Lord. That's $4,800 a year that the church gave to me as a raise. But Stacy and I said, no, we right now are living at the red exceeding our green, and we cannot throw more money at that. Why? Because then the red would match the green. It has to go beyond that. And so we said this. We said, we're not going to take the raise. We're going to give it back to the church, and we're going to do this with what we had because we got into this with what we had. And so we gave our raise back. Who does that when you're trying to pay off debt? But what I want to tell you is this. Because of the miraculous working of God, and there's hope for you because there was hope for us, that God, the source of our provision, we lived the last 2 years. We were Elijah at the brook where the crows and the ravens miraculously brought us provision outside of the church so that we were able to pay off all of our cars. We were able to pay off all of our credit cards. We were able to have a long-term savings account. We were able to have an emergency fund. We were able to invest in our retirement accounts through a diversified, not through just one, but multiple retirement areas. Why? So that I could stand here today 3 years later and tell you that I have no consumer credit card debt and I refuse the payments of a raise. Why? Because it's not about more money, it's about quality of life, and if God will do it for me through miraculous provision in my life, God will do it for you, because God is not a respecter of persons, and He wants you to live breathing room in your life, but it's going to take faith and trust to say, God, I'm going to make a decision to stop living the way I've been living and start living the way you want me to do. Now, the beautiful thing about that, and I'm not trying to tell you this to brag, the beautiful thing about that is that we have given to the church more than we ever thought we would be able to give. We were able to pay off our Freedom for Our Future pledge. On top of that, we were able to support the individual ministries and the individual missionaries around the world on our own finances, as well as through our gifts to the church, as well as Stacy and I, we were able to fund part of Swahili going into the International School of Ministry Translation so they could take the International School of Ministry into Swahili African language so that people could know about Jesus on top of everything else. Why? Because God is a God who will meet and exceed your standards. Like Ephesians 3:20, God is a God who will go farther above what you could ask or think, but it takes a decision to say, I'm going to listen and do what you've asked me to do, and I'm going to trust in you. Decide to make a change. Pick a number in your life. Watch your money. Cut your spending if you've got to cut your spending. Stop buying stuff you can't afford. You don't need that Venti Starbucks. Yes, I do. No, you don't. And develop a debt retirement plan. Why? Because when you listen to what God has for you, when you follow through with God's plans, God will come through. It happened to me. It'll happen to you. There is hope. Don't walk out of here with your head hung high or head hung low. Walk out of here saying, you know what, I got a new lease on life because I'm going to start doing something for God, and I'm going to see God start doing something in my life, and you will see miraculous. I just had a guy just between services tell me, Pastor Luke, him and I, we sat down with a debt retirement plan. Pastor Luke, he says, my debt is getting shredded right now. I mean, I'm just obliterating it right now. Why? Because God is miraculously providing. Just got an offer for a job, double his income. Why? Because he started living the precepts and the ideas that God has for his life. It does work. I'm telling you now, there's hope for you. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we come before you, Lord, and we thank you for this word. We thank you for the conviction, even though it's hard. Lord, I ask for peace and comfort. Lord, your word says that if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God and receive in faith. So, Lord, we ask for wisdom in our finances. We ask for wisdom in our life, Lord. We ask that you would help us to open our eyes to our money, to watch it, to see where it goes, that we would look and recognize what we can do to have breathing room in our life, because that is your plan. And God, if it's your plan and we follow your will, Lord, we know that it will come to pass. And so, God, we ask in the name of Jesus for peace and comfort as we make hard decisions. Lord, we ask for the discipline and the drive to continue on. And Lord, we ask for our motivation, Lord, for the Holy Spirit to say, you can do this. Equip us and comfort us. I ask for each and every person in this place, Lord, that you would give them peace to do this in Jesus' mighty name. We all together said, amen. Amen. Listen, before we leave today, I know that we're about done, and I know it's real tempting to get up and leave, but listen, give me a moment more of your time. I promise I'm not going to take much more of your time, but it's so important that you hang out and listen to what I have to say. I want to do something really quick. I want to ask you a question. I want you to examine your heart, examine your life. The Bible says that a man needs to examine himself from time to time. And I want you to think about this for a moment. If you were to die today, where would you go, heaven or hell? See, the Bible tells us that we're all one. The Bible tells us there's only two options for us, heaven or hell. There's no in between. You're not going to come back as a log or a frog or a dog or anything like that. You're going to come back or you're going to go heaven or hell. That's it. You see, we're all one accident. We're all one incident. We're all one epidemic away from our eternal destiny. And that's going to be heaven or hell. And the question is, if that happens to you, God forbid, where are you going to go? You see, nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope. Nowhere does it say that you can think. Nowhere does it say that you can wish that you're going to get into heaven, that you have the most positive outlook on life, and that means that God's going to look at you and say, yeah, that's it. That's all you got to do. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church on a regular basis, because you carry the pastor's Bible, you volunteer in a church, children's ministry, youth group, or you've got a card in your wallet that says you're a member of the church. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you lift your hands in praise and worship, or you've even given yourself the title of Christian, does it say that you're going to get into heaven? What? I thought Christians go to heaven. Did you know that Jesus says in his word that the people are going to come to him and say, Lord, didn't we cast out demons in your name? And he's going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I don't know you. Why? Because God's not interested in your hopes, your wishes, your dreams. God's not interested in your GPS location of where you're sitting on a Sunday morning. He's not interested in your service to a church ministry. These are not the things that you can buy or you can earn or you could deserve your way into heaven. But Pastor Luke, all my life, my parents told me I was a Christian. I was baptized or christened as a baby, confirmed. Listen, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because somebody blew smoke and water over you, said a prayer over you, that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere in God's word does it say that because you're a good person, because you do good things, you try to give to charitable organizations, you try to help out your fellow human being, you try to live a good life. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you're going to get into heaven. God's word tells us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. Why? Because the book of Romans tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody had to teach you how to lie. Nobody had to teach you how to steal. Nobody had to teach you how to cheat on that test that one time. You figured that out on your own. Why? Because there's an inherent sin on the inside of each and every one of us. And that has brought us to a place of separation with God. And nothing you and I could do on our own would ever make us good enough. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You don't deserve it. The only thing you can do is accept it. Well, but Pastor Luke, you know, I'm a spiritual person. I have a heightened sense of spirituality, and I believe that there's a higher power, a higher being. You know, 99.8% of the world believes in some form of a higher power. And you know, we'll all find it the same way. It's just different names and different looks. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that all roads lead to heaven? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. You know, Jesus is the only way you and I are going to find reconnection and connection with God. And eternal life in heaven. That's the only way, through Jesus. So how do we receive that? Well, the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But in that same verse, it tells us, but the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, you have the option. You can receive or you can accept that gift, or you can choose to reject or turn away from that gift. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way. And you have got to decide today. Are you going to give your heart, going to give your life to Jesus? What does that mean? Well, in the book of John, the third chapter, Jesus is speaking to a religious man, Nicodemus, a man who gave to the poor, did all the right things, memorized scripture, said all the right things. And Jesus says these words to Nicodemus. He says, Nicodemus, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. What does that mean? Well, it's not what Hollywood and society culture has made it out to be, weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. What does that mean? It means that this. It means you've given all of your heart. You've given all of your life to God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. It's an all-or-nothing relationship. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his churches. Jesus says this to his church. He says, listen, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I will vomit you from my mouth. What does that mean, vomit? Jesus is saying, listen, if you're not all in, you're not going to make it. I love you enough and I respect you enough today to tell you the truth. Lukewarm Christians are not going to make it. What does it mean to be lukewarm? You got a little bit in, you're a little bit out with your relationship with God. You kind of got your ups and your downs. Occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Listen, you're not wholehearted for God, but you're not wholehearted against God. You know, Sunday's all about God's day, but Monday through Saturday, it's all about you. Listen, I love you enough and respect you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it according to the Word of God. But that doesn't have to be the final answer. That doesn't have to be the final solution of your life. Why? Because in that very same scripture, Jesus says these words to that church. He says, listen, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And he says, whoever opens the door, he says, I will come in, and I will be with them, and they will be with me, and we will be together. Jesus says, I'm knocking on the door of your heart. And he says, all you need to do is open up your heart, open up your life to me. Receive me as your Lord and Savior. He says, I will be with you. Give all of your heart, give all of your life to Jesus Christ. How do we do that? Today, I don't want to do it your way or my way or even some well-meaning author or church committee's way. Let's do it God's way. Jesus says these words. He said that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. But if you deny him, he said, he will deny you before his Father. The decision is yours. God's not going to force his way. He's not going to kick open the door of your heart. Well, if God wants me, he'll take me. God wanted you so bad, he gave Jesus, his only begotten Son, his most valuable possession for you and for me to die on a cross for our sin and for our shame so that we could be reunited and reconnected to God. The decision's yours and totally yours. How are we going to do that today? I want to do it like this. I'm going to tell you, I'll do it like this. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. I'm going to go like this. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And if that's you in this place, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. What am I going to ask you to do? I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing today by the raising of your hand is you're deciding, like we talked about today. You're making a decision to change in your life. You're saying, you know what? I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. What you're talking about today, Pastor Luke, you're talking right to me. I feel like maybe I haven't been there all my life. Maybe I haven't been serving God or I haven't been going after Jesus Christ. And I don't know who God is. I know all about him, but I don't know him personally. And God says, it's not about your mental ascent towards him. God says, I want you to know me personally. I want you to know the desires of my heart too. And it starts by developing a relationship with Jesus Christ, and it starts by making a decision. That's what raising your hand is. Well, I'm going to be embarrassed if I raise my hand. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm not here to pick you out, single you out, tease you. I'm here to build you up. That's my life's purpose, to build you up. And the decision comes today. It starts today. Are you going to make the decision? The Spirit of God's knocking on the door of your heart, saying it's time for you to come home. It's time for you to choose life. You've been doing it your way far too long. It's time for you to start doing it God's way. Are you going to make the decision today? And that's what you're doing by raising your hand. You see, I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back there. Who should raise your hands if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus? If that's you in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, man, I hear a lot of people say, man, I hope so, or I want to. I don't know, man. I hope so. Listen, the Bible tells us that the Spirit of God is given to us on the inside of us as God's seal of approval for us. God does not want you walking around life groping in the dark, hoping that you're going to make it. God says, I have given you my spirit to live on the inside of you so that you would know without a shadow of a doubt that you are in the right position, in the right place with me. And so if that's you today and you're not sure, do not walk out of this place today without making sure. Today is the day of your salvation. If you've been living lukewarm, running from God instead of to God, if you've been playing games, doing your own thing, listen, it's time to give all of your heart, give all of your life to Jesus Christ. It's time to make a decision to change in your life and accept the invitation of Jesus Christ today. The decision's yours and totally yours. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now it's a divine appointment. All across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, side to side, I don't care if you've been in this church for 26 years or 26 minutes. You guys in the family rooms, out watching on closed circuit television around the campus, or even at home online via the live stream, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time of your salvation. The decision is here and yours to make. And I'm going to count to three in just a moment. If that's you, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, you can put it right back down, and we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together, and we're going to be included in that. But it starts today by making a decision. You ready? I'm going to count to three. If that's you, this is your moment, this is your time. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three. I see you. Four, I see you. Five, six. I see you guys right over there. Six wise people. I got you guys over here. Six wise people. Anybody over here on this side? Six people. Anybody else? I'm saying, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. The Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. This is your moment. This is your time. Anybody else today? I got you, my man. I see you, my man. I see you guys. Anybody else in this place today? I see the ushers are pointing back over there. I see you right over there in the middle. I see you guys right over here in the back. I see you guys right over there. All right, I got you. All over this place, about 10 wise people. Anybody else? See, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, the time is now. Quit playing games. Quit messing around. It's your day of salvation. Your whole life's about to change, but it starts by making that decision. Anybody else today? About 10 wise people. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for the 10 or so wise people. That's great. Now, here's what we're going to do. You're making a decision, and I said this. I said we're going to pray a prayer together. Now it's time to follow up with that decision, to make a change. You're deciding to make a change. Now it's time to act in discipline and do it. So if you raise your hand, here's what I want you to do. If you raise your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you should have, and you know that. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with somebody, look at them and say, will you go with me? Or they raise their hand right next to you and say, come on, I'll go with you. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. As we all stand together, my friend Elijah is going to sing a song. All of 10 of you, and maybe you're number 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, you should have raised your hands. Come on, wherever you're at, get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come and meet me right here. We're going to change destinies right now.
Jesus, I believe. You're the reason that I live. You're the
reason that I live. Come on, you come from the back, wherever you're at.
Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. The reason that I
live. Well, listen, not everybody that raised their hands came, and I just got to tell you the truth. Listen, I love you enough. I've been hard on you all day. You're like, man, I should have gone somewhere else. But you got to have somebody that loves you enough to tell you the truth, even when it hurts. You're not going to get saved because you raise your hand in a church service. If you can't go forward for Jesus in a warm and welcome place like the church, what makes you think you're going to do it outside the walls of these buildings in the real world? The decision is yours. So I'm going to ask Elijah to sing that. I know we've gone late, but I'm going to ask Elijah to sing that. If that's you, you come on. You get out of your seat. You get out of your chair. The Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. It's time to respond today. Come on. If that's you in this place, this is your moment of salvation today. Come on.
Jesus, I believe.
Yeah, good. Wherever you're at, if that's you, come on.
Jesus, I belong to you.
You guys don't have to kneel down. It's okay. Here's what we're going to do. Just a moment. I said we're all going to pray together. So here's what I'm going to do. Even for you guys kneeling down, check it out. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple things with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I'm as weird as it gets, and you have survived, all right? You've made it, okay? Here's what he's going to do. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to ask Jesus to come into your heart, come into your life. He's going to give you some free information. We're going to give you some literature to help point you in the right direction for the rest of your life. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back, to get connected with a friend, somebody here at the church that will meet with you, teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to your life, but you go forward in everything Jesus has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend Pastor Joel. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Praise God.